Okay, hello everybody. I hope I'm audible to all of you. My name is Kedar Soni and I'm going to be your host today. And we're going to have this nice little program where we're going to learn a few things about COVID, about scientific temper. And also we're going to have an interaction with some of you young people here and know what you think about all these things. I think I'll just share my screen for a few minutes. I'll let more people to join in. All right, so just please watch my screen and give us a couple of minutes. We'll start soon. In the meantime, Rohini, I hope you have the latest sequence with you.
Hello, everyone. This is Rohini Karandikar, and I welcome you all to this program. We are still seeing participants join. So, okay, we begin with the program. So we welcome you all on behalf of the entire team of Mumbai March for Science to this live online event today. And as you saw on the screen, there are a number of small sessions that are lined up. We have specially invited students from all over the city who had sent their posters, wonderful posters and photographs. We'll be interacting with them. We also have students, senior students from who belong to different colleges in Mumbai, and we are going to interact with them on scientific temper. Before we begin with our first presentation today, I would request Dr. Aniket Sule from Homi Bhabha Center for Science Education to give us a brief introduction to what March for Science is and how it all started. Over to Aniket.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. So I'm not sure, probably younger students have heard this phrase March for Science for the first time. So March for Science is a movement which started in 2017. It is not just Indian thing, it is all over the world. So in 2017, many scientists, they felt that all the common people are going away from the science. In a sense, there is a lot of confusing information available in social media, which people tend to believe, and they don't really understand science, the modern science, and they don't trust the modern science. So also, because the common people are what politicians care about, as common people started mistrusting modern science, politicians also started going away from science and scientists. So to gain back their trust, to make science and scientists connect to back to society, this March for Science was initiated. It started with just a symbolic march in more than 400 cities around the world. It happened in April 2017. We did not get coordinate, unfortunately, with the rest of the world, and we had our first march in August 2017 instead. And since then, every year we have been holding the marches, and Rohini will say something more about that. But I would like to say few things why these are necessary. One thing I said, that to connect science and scientists to the to society. But what we do by connecting them to society, we want to spread the correct correct scientific information to people, make people understand science by being friendly with them, and through that we would also like to make the policyholders understand the importance of doing science in the correct way. So we want policyholders to go with the evidence-backed policies, not just you think something is correct, so you do something. It should not be like that. It should be properly backed by the evidence. We should adhere to scientific temper in our thinking. And all these things which we have been saying for last few years, they became more important in last few months because of this COVID pandemic. This is one case where science really has to come to forefront, and the evidence and scientific evidence and scientific temper should be the key to decision making. Unfortunately, we have seen that that is not always the case. In last few months, we have seen a lot of misinformation about COVID as well. And this year, since we are still in partial lockdown, we cannot meet face to face. That is why for this year's online event, we thought the theme should also be COVID and scientific temper. And thank you all for participating in that. So with all this background, I think Rohini will talk about March for Science has done, especially March for Science Mumbai has done in past 4 years. And then we'll go to the next part.
Thank you, Aniket, for that introduction. And I would like to now give a very brief glimpse of what we have done so far in March for Science. Can you all see I hope you can see the presentation.
Yes, yes, ma'am, it's loading.
Okay. Like he said, we started in 2017 and we had the very first march, and we were joined by a number of students, science educators, communicators and teachers from all over the city. Some of them had prepared nice posters, and we all marched together to unite for science. And as you can read, it said science, not silence. So after 2017, we also had a march in 2018 and 2019. This year, because of the lockdown, we are not marching, but yes, we have united for this session, the live event. I just want to show you a video which gives a glimpse of one of our previous marches. I'm just waiting for it to load. Yes. I'm sorry, I'm not able to play it. We'll go ahead with the presentation. Yes, so after the March for Science 2017, it was decided that just meeting once a year may not be enough. If we really want to bridge the gap between the science and society, then it is also essential to do a sustained interaction with the public for their better understanding of science. That's how this initiative called Curiosity Circle was born, and that was for the engagement of public and engagement for the public for better understanding of science. And this event takes place in until the lockdown. We organized this in different parts of the city so that people from different region can actually join this Curiosity Circle talk. And the talks so far have been held on various topics like the real ancient science in India, or rational thought in society, panel discussion on climate crisis, and so on. So all our videos are available on our YouTube channel of Curiosity Circle. You all can subscribe to the channel and take a look at the various talks. Curiosity Circle is not the only other activity that was taken recently after this Black Lives Matter movement of the US, a similar movement was also initiated by March for Science Mumbai on the different injustices that people in academia face. So there was a 7-part series on social justice and Indian academia on topics like gender justice, sexual identities, caste equation, inclusion of ethnic minorities, pigeonholes of religion, ableism in academia, and barriers of class and burden of English. Just last week, we had a discussion on the understanding of the National Education Policy 2020. The NEP 2020 was recently released by the central government, and there was a lot of discussion happening around the understanding of what NEP is, what it really means. And we had experts from various fields who discussed with us and other people on various topics related to NEP. So all the videos of the social justice in Indian academia and the talk for the understanding NEP 2020 is available, or all these videos are available on our YouTube channel. Please subscribe to the channel and take a look. With that, I'll just hand over to Kedar for the next part of the function.
Okay, thank you, Rohini, and thank you, Aniket, for the nice introduction to what is March for Science. For the younger people here, just to quickly recap that idea that March for Science is for you people. You know, for people who are in primary school right now, or in secondary school, or who are going to go to college, and who may go for science eventually. You know, it's for you to really understand what science is about and to try and get that temper inside you. We'll talk more about this eventually. But now we have a small demonstration, or it's a very nice demonstration. And Anna Bhattacharya, a scientist from CIFR, who likes to call himself as a tinkerer, which I really like the word tinkerer. So he's going to show you how we get check marks, if they're good or not. All right, so please let's hand over to Arnab from the land.
Hi, can people hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, so you can hear me, you can see me, and well, if there's one thing COVID-19 has taught us, is that we all need to wear this mask whenever we leave home. And unfortunately, there are just so many varieties of masks floating around. You can go to Amazon or Flipkart and search for masks, and you get a huge variety, which is so difficult to understand what is what. And again, here is where having a scientific mindset when you look at something is really helpful. Now, scientific temper is not just for scientists. It's for everybody. It's for how we look at a problem. Do we look at it rationally? Do we try and ask questions? And asking questions is the most important thing. And there are so many masks which actually claim that they are, you know, to have some amazing filtration efficiency, or they are washable or something else. And it's time to ask, is it really true? Okay. And to do that, actually, we were looking at something called the N95 masks. The N95 masks are masks which, you know, my face doesn't look very good. I'm just going to switch cameras so I can show you what we are doing in the lab. That's probably the more exciting thing. So let me just see if I can switch the camera. If I switch my camera, there we are. So I have tons of masks over here, and a typical N95 mask is something which looks like this. This is an N95 mask, and this is supposed to block 95% of particles of a particular size. And this is very important. Particular size is 0.3 microns. And that is about the size of the smallest droplets that you have. The virus is only about 100 nanometers or 0.1 microns. The virus is not by itself, it's typically in very small droplets. Now, mostly what you will also see are masks like this. These masks, which can either have these little elastic straps at the ear, so this one has elastic straps at the ear, and some of them also will have maybe this one has some ties you can tie behind your head, okay? So these masks, these are called surgical masks. Okay? Now, one of the biggest problems is the way these masks are classified and you know, the specifications that they have to meet. Now, if you have a surgical mask is specified by something called the bacterial filtration efficiency, which is at a size of 3 microns. 3 microns, what is your filtration efficiency? 3 microns is what this is stored. You need to have 95% efficiency at 3 microns. For an N95 mask, which are these masks, you need to have a 95% efficiency at 0.3 microns. That's 10 times smaller. And this is a cause of a lot of confusion. There's a lot of confusion because people really, you know, actually measure one thing and claim something else. And many times these claims are actually not valid at all. In fact, what is worse is that there is a lot of things which are, so I'll show you, here is a mask which says some PSN95. Now you cannot make up your own designation. Here is some other mask which says Urban Shield P95. There's nothing like P95. You're either N95 or you're not N95. You can't make up anything you like of LS95 and SS95 and W95 or whatever else. Okay. And these will often tell, then this is why you need to read carefully. If you read this, it says lab tested. But it doesn't say what was tested. And it has, if you look at the backside, it has even some logos of, you know, something. But none of these are agencies that certify masks. Okay. It says meet some standard, but it doesn't say what is the particle filtration efficiency anywhere. And now when you see something like something claiming it's a P95, you might think it's something related to an N95, but no, it's not. Now, how do you know this? And actually, our thing started off by interacting with doctors at Tata Memorial Hospital who were having serious problems deciding which of these masks they had received. And most of these masks, all of these masks actually come from Tata Memorial Hospital. In fact, there's also AN95 is very popular. AN95 is actually a Chinese designation, but it clearly says it's a non-medical mask. If you look at it, they will tell you it's meant for, you know, different things, but not for in an environment. And also, one thing while we are on masks, never ever have a mask with a valve. Many masks have these little valves on them, and these valves are effectively evil because a mask serves two purposes. So many masks have these valves. Okay. And this is a very fancy, expensive mask which claims to be antiviral, but it's really not, doesn't filter very well. A mask is also supposed to protect the wearer's own, you know, when I'm speaking, I'm shedding droplets from my mouth. If I cough or something, the mask must protect my own droplets from going outside, which they don't do. So we thought, okay, we need to figure out how do we test masks. And it was the lockdown. And we decided we would build something in the lab with whatever was there. And Aniket, certainly, I don't know if you remember this ball. This was, you have seen this ball in Ooty. This was used to make a ball mirror arrangement. And we took whatever we could find at home. Balls. You can even see that this thing on top, this is what comes in a pizza box. These three-legged things to keep your pizza apart. We decided to do stuff made from things at home using a particle counter. So what we have, now, thanks to air pollution, there are lots of people who are doing pollution monitoring. And these pollution monitoring boxes, okay, what they do, they measure these PM2.5 and PM10 levels in the air. But some of the chips used in pollution monitors also measure 0.3 microns. So what we have is this, a little box over here, which actually measures it. And what we are doing is we have a pump. We have a pump over here. And from the pump, I am going through a flow meter, so I know how many liters a minute I'm pulling. And it goes through the particle counter and through this, and I'm pumping air from here. So this thing is currently sucking air from the room, and I have a little, we've written a teeny software to do it. I'm going to say start. And what it is going to do, hopefully, just when you want it to work is just when it doesn't work. Okay, let's see. It's going to take some time. Yeah, hopefully, okay, the hotspot's on. This is going to measure. It's going to measure every 20 seconds. It's going to tell me how many particles did that counter count. And it counted something like 3,400 particles. And what I can do is, you know, I can see how many particles are there in room air. There are enough of these 0.3 micron particles in room air. And then I can put a mask on this. So I'm going to ask Divya to do this. Of course, there's going to be some variation because this is just a, you know, the number of particles coming through, there's breeze. So it's not going to be a constant. There's some particles coming through, but there's about, I would say, 3,400, 3,500 particles are coming through every 20 seconds. And what I can do is I will take a mask. Let's take a mask which we know is reasonably good. So I'm going to take a mask and just put this mask on the holder. Put this mask over here. Well, I don't have a face. All I have is a ball. And I don't have ears. My ball doesn't have ears. There are just two little keelas over here, nails, on which I can put my mask. So there is my mask. Now, one of the things is because this ball has been so badly beaten up and we've cut it to put wires inside, it's not going to seal perfectly over here. And it's not the mask is designed to seal on your face, which is not a circle, not a sphere. So I'm going to take some sticky tape and just tape it so that there's no leakage from the side. Okay, I'm going to just tape it. I will tape it so that there is no leakage inside of the mask. Tape it there. Tape it there. All right. Okay. So now if you can come here and let's look at the screen, what you see is initially we had some number of particles that it was counting in air. As I have put on the tape, the particle count is going down and we will eventually reach some stable number. Okay. And let's see what happens for the next point. Should go quite further down. And if I just look at the ratio of the number of counts now I'm getting through the mask versus the number of counts in air, I can easily figure out the filtration efficiency of this thing. Okay. And I can do that. Look, it's still going down, still going down. I can actually even calculate the efficiency. So I can define which region is my mask, which region is not my mask. So the red part is the room air count. The green part is my mask count. It's still going down. We'll have to give it, normally I would have let this be stable for a few minutes. And now it is getting stable. So if you look at the counts here, it's probably still not stable. But you can see we are already down to about, you can see it's about 90% efficiency. We are already measuring 90% efficiency right now. And if we leave it stabilized, we can go on. So this is a very, very simple mask tester. But this simple mask tester has actually taught us a lot of things. It's taught us that many, many masks that are being sold as N95 actually are not N95 at all. In fact, the more somebody advertises that their mask is N95, it's probably not. So anybody who has a mask which says that the performance has actually been certified and tested by somebody, okay, nobody's supposed to advertise that. Cetra has put out an advertisement. Don't, companies are not supposed to write certified by Cetra or tested. Testing is one thing. You send the material to them, they only test it once. Certification is something completely different. Certification means you have a process where, every run you are doing some analysis. There are only 12 companies in India that are certified to make N95 masks. So everybody else, they can put stickers saying it's N95, but it's probably, you have to be very careful. Some of them are. They're just not able to certify it. There's a lot of backlog. But you have to be very careful. The other thing is just remember that these masks were designed to be used and thrown. Okay, because they were used infrequently. But now, in a situation with COVID-19, where healthcare workers, doctors, nurses, whoever, have to wear these N95 masks or surgical masks, they're wearing them almost, 4 hours, 8 hours at a stretch, right? Imagine if every 4 hours or 8 hours, you use the mask and you had to throw it. You would generate enormous amounts of waste, right? Now, the problem is you wash your hands with soap and water. You can remove all the virus. COVID-19, the SARS-CoV-2 virus does not survive, right? You can put a few drops of alcohol. You kill the virus. Unfortunately, it's not easy to do that to a mask. And that is because of a beautiful physics of how masks actually filter. You can think of a filter as a channi, a sieve that you use in a kitchen, right? You have a a mesh with holes in it. You put some particles, whatever is smaller than the particles, they will go through. That works for large particles, and that's how most of these things filter. They are essentially sieves. But with a sieve, if I had to go down and filter very small particles, 0.3 micron particles, I'd have to make the gaps so small that there would be a lot of difficulty to breathe through the mask. You can make masks. People have tried to make masks. You can make some really thick masks, very thick masks. These are almost unbreathable. They will be so thick. I mean, you know, you can take a stainless steel vati and put it around your face. Think of it. That is 100% filtration efficiency, right? But it doesn't let any air through. So you have a compromise. You need to make a compromise. I need it to be breathable. Air must come through it. On the other hand, it must stop particles. And that's where you use electric charge. So the difference, the big difference between a good N95 mask and a simple surgical mask is that this thing has a layer inside which has electric charge. And this electric charge is what attracts the particles. And by washing it or by putting it in alcohol, you are removing the charge. So now you can see that I'm actually washing. I mean, if you can see, I have been doing an experiment where I am washing masks, and I'm you can see some masks drying over there, perhaps. You can probably see there are masks that are drying. So we have been washing masks. We've been trying to see, can you actually reuse masks? And it turns out that actually, in many cases, some of these surgical masks can be reused a few times before they get completely useless. The other thing is, but you have to be very careful how you wash them. You have to be very, very careful how you wash them. The other thing is that we found that there are several ways one can actually regenerate the efficiency in a mask, which is something obviously it's not very easy to show you right now. Okay, but there it is. You saw our particle counts have sort of stabilized right now. And I'm going to remove it again. We will take it off and see whether the particle counts go back up. Okay, so this is obviously, this was not a great check. I didn't really check that I had made it absolutely leak tight. So this was a good mask. And now, just for the fun of it, let's take one of these very nice N, you know, whatever. And these masks are so popular. These are masks which have this, they look like a little mesh. I see a lot of people using these masks. Let's see how good these are. It says P95, right? P95. Let's see how good a P95 is. So put it here. Put it here. Oh, come on. Where is it? Okay, there we go. And there we go. And of course, we should do the same thing. We should not allow leaks. So I will take my tape. Make sure that there are no leaks. We will tape it at the side. We'll tape it at the side. Okay, so we leave this, and you can see what happened is the, you know, this was our good mask. The particle counts went up, and they're going down again. And let's see what happens. Let's see whether this is 90% or does it come close or whatever else. Okay, we have taped this well. Yes, we have taped this well. Okay, so So the things to remember: be very careful about these masks with valves. Don't use masks with valves. And now there is, you know, when you see masks. You can see so many masks. There are masks which cost, this mask costs, this is 2 rupees. This is 2 rupees. These masks are 3 rupees, 6 rupees, 20 rupees. What's the difference? And how do you make out at home? Right? It's very difficult, right? But it's actually reasonably, if you want to do an absolute simple check, with no filtration efficiency equipment, what you can do is just take the mask and hold it up and try and look at a tube light or look at a light bulb or look at your camera's flash, right? If you look at the light through this and you can see the light, That's actually a very bad sign for a surgical mask. It means there are too many gaps, because remember, this is the one which is basically just doing a sieve kind of filtration. A good surgical mask will have at least three layers, and many of the very cheap ones, so this one, for example, actually you can cut it. I can cut it and show you it has only two layers. It doesn't have a third layer. So always make sure your mask has three layers at least. And believe me, you can make very good masks at home with all the cloth that's lying around. If you have a standard, a typical t-shirt, right? Hosiri material actually works very well if you double it up or make three layers of it. You can just cut up, you know, make a cloth mask which is going to go over your face, because the virus, you don't have to really worry about the 0.3 micron. Though we've made all this, that's for, yes, if you want to make an N95 for healthcare workers, that's really important. But for most of us, we are going to pick up droplets from other people. And these are large droplets. These are micron-sized droplets. And that is going to be effectively stopped by most masks. Most masks and even cloth masks are very effective at the larger sizes. And even for the fine 0.3 micron particles, if you double this, you will get almost 50% efficiency. So this cloth mask, these green typical hospital cloth masks, are about 50% efficient even at 0.3 microns. And look at this. Now the number has stabilized. So if I move this thing here, so that's barely 60%. So it's barely about 60% efficient. So even though it said P95 and made you think it was 95% efficient, it actually wasn't. It was just about 60%. And 60% is something you could get by just taking four layers of a t-shirt, right? So why do you want to pay, MRP 249 rupees for something which is really not tested and has all kinds of stickers which have nothing to do with market testing? So this is what scientific temper is about. You must read and ask questions about things. And often it is just enough to read what is written. I mean, many times, they will itself write on the package that it's not meant for medical use, which means it's not going to be a mask which is that thing. It says it's meant for only for pollen and bacteria and to filter out the, dust. It's not meant for viruses. It says that. Most people will not even read it. They'll say, it sounds like N95, let's just get it. So I'm happy to, I think I've done a lot of talking. I'll be very happy to actually take questions and try and answer anything that people might want to say. So let's, why don't we flip it so I can get back to the video and yeah. You switched it. Okay, yeah, you.
Okay, Arnab, thanks for this demonstration. This is a very nice.
Yeah, are you muted?
Am I muted? Sorry, no, I'm. Are you able to hear
Kedar, me? Are you muted?
No, are you able to hear
me?
Hear
you.
Yes.
No, we can hear Kedar.
Okay. All right, maybe Arnab is having some trouble.
No, it's fine. For some reason, when we were doing this thing, we had turned the thing off. Okay, so I'm just going to sit down and hold the phone for a little easier for me. And see if I can balance my.
Okay, so we will take some questions from the participants, and there are already some coming in, and we're going to pop them to Arnab. I just want to have a quick point here between the questions and before we go to those things. I just thought of a process. You just said that if you take a light source and pop the mask in front of the light source, you could probably see the amount of light which is cut out.
I mean, that's a very, very, very crude way of doing things.
Sure. But that could be like, I just thinking that maybe if you have, take a camera with a LED source, I mean a light source, take another phone which has got a light counter, the easily available apps, and put a mask in between, and with some calibration, with some amount of calibration after a while, maybe you could use that to know at least if it's going to say roughly 90% or roughly 80% or roughly 50%.
I think to sort of make a quantitative calibration with filtration efficiency is very difficult, because beyond a certain point, you are depending on electrical charge. And what you are sensitive to in the optics transmission experiment is just the density of material that you have. So it works fine for a cheap surgical mask where it is, you're just comparing the, you're effectively, it's like you're comparing how many threads per inch or whatever they call it is there between the layers of cloth mask. This will not work for N95. So you can't quantitate it.
Right. Okay. So let's come to the questions.
But you can also do something. I mean, you can also if mm-hmm. I wear a mask and I can check whether I can cough or sneeze and see if I can feel anything coming out. Right. That's also a reasonable test. Or can you blow out a candle flame? Can you blow an agarbatti smoke, for example, which will normally go vertically up? Right. Mm-hmm. Can you blow it out? Can you bend the agarbatti smoke with your breath wearing the mask? Obviously, these are a little qualitative because you're not going to be able to blow exactly the same way every time. But these are very simple tests you can do.
Right. Okay. Thanks, Adab. Coming to questions. I think Das Gupta sir is asking a question about how to wash a mask. You said you are washing masks. How do you actually wash them?
So it depends on the mask. So if it's a cloth mask, I just toss it in the washing machine and I dry it on the line, and that's it. And I think that is what most people should use. Just use cloth masks, wash them. You know, I have multiple masks so that in Mumbai, nothing dries in one day. So I have, you know, many of these, so old t-shirts and all, you can keep using them in a cycle. Now, if you are washing a N95 mask, you will degrade its efficiency. So you will go from 95 to about 80%. So if you're happy with an 80% mask, you can wash an N95 mask. But just remember that if you wash an N95 or some of these very high-end surgical masks, they are just the same as an N95 mask. It's only the shape that is different. The material is the same, right? The N95 mask has this cup shape or the what is called this is called the duckbill mask because it looks like a duckbill. So these are the two shapes, common shapes of these masks. These will go down to about 80% if you wash them. That's basically you're removing the charge from the layer. 80% is what you will get just by the filtration of the pores. If you have to recharge it, it's very, very difficult. I mean, we have tried some things, but it's not something very easily doable at home. On the other hand, if you are worried about decontaminating a mask, that is, I have a mask, I have used it for several hours, I am worried that it may be contaminated with the virus, and I want to reuse it. Decontaminating a mask with basically moist heat is relatively easy. I can explain it, how you could do it at home, but there is also a very, very nice website called n95decon.org. N95decon is a group of volunteers who have come across from around the world who have just come together and trying to solve problems related to masks in a spirit of, you know, open collaboration. And they have a huge list of protocols of how you can use different techniques to, but the idea is this: if you can keep your mask at a temperature of 70 degrees for more than half an hour in moist heat or 70 degrees dry heat for an hour, that is sufficient to get rid of the virus. Or if you just want to keep it, if I take a mask, I use it today and I keep it somewhere in an open place, which is airy, and I use it after 5 days, I use it on the sixth day. The virus doesn't survive on any surface for more than 5 days. So that's one way to do it. The only problem is we are always breathing in and out. Our breath also, we have our own pathogens and, you know, whatever. They're not pathogens for us, but there is own microflora inside our mouth. Those can get stuck to your mask, and then you can start growing stuff, you know, in a nice humid environment. So it's best if you can do a heat treatment. And getting 70 degrees is actually very easy with hot water. Be very careful in a microwave because the masks have a metal strip inside which goes and bends on your nose. And if you put it in a microwave oven, it will spark. So that's something which can be dangerous. So it's best to use, dry heat or wet heat in an oven somehow, which is not a microwave oven. Or by putting it, you just pour boiling water in some dish and have a second vessel inside it. I can give you details. I can share these details with March for Science Mumbai, and you can circulate it to all the people.
Sure. Okay. The next question is from a school kid, I believe. It's why should we not use the mask with balls? What's wrong with balls?
Oh, okay. the mask with valves. So here is an example of a mask with a valve, and you should never use it. Now, the mask serves two purposes. This mask, when I wear a mask, it serves two purposes. The mask is supposed to stop particles outside, pathogens coming in. But it is also supposed to stop my own droplets going out. Now, these masks are meant for pollution. They're meant for people who are in dusty environments. Maybe they're in mines. Maybe they're scraping walls for painting, etc. Okay. The mask, the valve is a rubber gasket over here. The rubber gasket provides a pretty much a zero resistance path for particles outside. So if a particle is going out, it's not stopped by this valve. And hence, it makes breathing easier. But it also means that whatever you're breathing in, whatever you're breathing out, is going out without any protection at all. Okay. And there's a second problem. The second problem is, especially in Mumbai, which is a very humid place, and even if it's not, your breath that you're breathing out is humid. Eventually, this rubber gasket is going to get wet. Rubber is a very sticky material. One piece of dust that sticks to this material, the valve will never close tightly again. And then even when breathing in, the valve is not going to close, and your N95 mask, even if it's N95, has gone. That's it. It's not N95 anymore. So, yeah, that was the reason for not using valve mask.
Right.
Happy to take more questions.
Yeah, there are a lot of more questions, actually. So I'll come to them. There's another question about UV sterilization and steam sterilization, but I think you already spoke about that.
UV is my another thing where scientific temper is most important. Okay, there are tons of people selling these dabbas, UV boxes for sterilization. First thing, sterilization itself is a technical term. Sterilization means you are reducing the bacterial or pathogen count by 99.999%, what is called a 5-9 reduction or a log 5 reduction. Disinfection or decontamination is only 99.9%. Okay? But forget all that. Let's say even if I reduce by 99%, I'm happy. Okay. But the point is, you need a minimum dosage of UV. And a dosage is some intensity for some amount of time. So they will specify that, for example, for SARS-CoV-2, you need 1 joule per centimeter squared. That's the thing. So if I have a lamp, which gives me so many milliwatts per centimeter squared, I have to multiply it by a time to get energy per centimeter squared. Now, unfortunately, many of these people who are selling these boxes, they are using the standard lights, the tube lights, the UV lights that people use in AquaGuard and water purifiers. Okay. Now, an 11 watt UV lamp does not produce 11 watt of UV. Otherwise, you would never see it glow blue. It actually produces only 25% of the power in the UV. Okay. So an 11 watt tube light is like approximately a 3-point-something watt UV power. And then, not all that power, there is also inverse square law, right? You're going to, as you're not right next to the lamp, that power is going all, everywhere. How much power are you getting on your surface? If your surface is not, like if I put a mask, it's extremely difficult. I need to do something. My phone is balanced between a roll of sticky tape and a mask. So, yeah, we can try putting it inside the, yeah, that works. We put it inside a sellotape holder, so that's going to work, but I can't see myself anymore. But that should be fine. Where were we? Yeah, if I have a mask like this, okay, as long as if the UV is coming this way, it's fine. But if I was coming, UV is coming this way, it's almost tangential to it. So there's not going to be much intensity hitting your mask. So UV sterilization is a very, very, very tricky thing. And just having one or two lamps, I mean, you know, to get a reasonable amount, if you want to get even 10 milliwatts per centimeter squared, you actually need lots of lamps. And it's not easy to design. We're trying to design a UV cabinet which will work, but to get sufficient UV intensity, most of the cabinets that I've seen actually don't work very well. What was the next question?
Right. So there's another one about, Bojit Sain is asking that I once saw a video where a mask was put over a cup of water and heated in a microwave to steam it. Will that work?
So the thing is this, if that mask did not have any metal parts, it may work. Okay. But the problem is you want to make a prescription which is sort of, you know, you don't know which mask somebody has. The problem with microwaves is that if your mask has a metal, and most of these things have a metal nose piece inside it, there is an aluminium strip over here, and some of them it's outside. So this mask has it outside, so you can clearly see it. Right? anything is put in a microwave, it will start sparking. The metal can get locally very hot and burn your mask over there. So I would not recommend a microwave for using it. It's much better if you can boil the water somewhere else and hold it in the steam for half an hour. That could work. But please be very careful with the microwave. I will try and summarize mask decontamination methods and send a note to Mark.
Great. I think there are some more questions, but they're on the same lines that you've already spoken about. So if there's any other question, I'll just check. Otherwise, we can move on. Just a moment. Well, there's one question from Mohammed. It says, how about de-slicing a concave field of UV tubes and then placing the mask in question at the focal point one side at a time?
Well, the thing is this, ideally, you want to make something which is not, whenever you have focused light, you have a huge variation in intensity across it, right? So the idea is to try and get as uniform an intensity as possible. And the best thing to do is, because you don't want to worry about this angular dependence, you want to have as much diffuse reflectance as possible. And actually, the easiest thing to get diffuse reflectance is crumpled aluminium foil. Crumpled and aluminium turns out to be a much better reflector at UV wavelengths than polished stainless steel or something. So the easiest thing to do is to actually make this aluminium foil and use that to make sure you're diffusing the reflectance and doing it. Having a focused UV thing is not necessarily going to be useful for mask decontamination. What is the difference between, I just saw a question flash on my screen, washing a mask with UV. You can't wash a mask with UV. You can decontaminate a mask with UV light. UV will break up the DNA of the pathogen. Water washing is, of course, water washing. It's very different. The problem with water washing is you could, if you use soap and water, you will probably remove the charge from N95 mask and hence impact the filtration.
Okay, Arap, I think it's really time we have to move on. Thanks a lot for the whole thing.
Thanks a lot. And, please feel free to send me questions over email and I will try and write this up and send
it. Absolutely. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. So let's move on. Now the kids are here. I mean, some of the kids here are waiting definitely to interact about what they have done. Because we need to give prizes at the end of this. There was a competition held and some of you have sent your entries for that. So, we need to just know what you were thinking about when you did that poster or that photo, and we'll be coming to that in a moment. So I'll just stay my screen and we'll take up this work of yours of students one by one. Just give me a second. Okay, so I believe there's a poster here, interesting one by Ravi Singh. Ravi Kumar Singh, are you there? Are you in this group here, are you in this chat?
Ravi Kumar Singh from Guru Nanak Higher Secondary School, Ranchi. Are you there? All right. We can go to the next.
I'll take the next one. So if not Ravi, we'll come back to him maybe later. I think Krishna Chauhan is definitely here.
So Krishna Chauhan from St. Xavier School.
Okay. So what I want you to do is like this. Krishna Chauhan, if you're getting this, you send this photo for the competition. What I want to know from you, first of all, tell us exactly what you're doing and what you're studying or what you want to do in life. And then tell me what you found interesting about this picture. Why did you take this particular picture here? Is that the one? You'll need to unmute yourself, I think. Can we do that? Okay, can somebody unmute him for me?
No, the participant actually unmute himself. So, okay.
That should work, right?
Is he there in the
participant? He was there. He asked a question earlier.
They control.
Yeah. I can hear you. Krishna Chauhan, right?
They control the population during this pandemic.
Sorry, is there a lot of background noise coming from your phone? I mean,
before. leave for the
Can you please repeat that?
Oh, sorry, sorry.
They control the population during this pandemic.
It controls the population. You mean to say it manages people, doesn't allow people to go into, like, make a crowd. Is that what you're saying, Krishna?
Yes.
Okay. But then just tell us also, like, you know, what you're doing. Like, what are you studying right now?
8th standard.
Okay, good. Okay, that's nice. All right, Krishna, thank you for that thing. So we'll just move to the next participant. There's some more things to share. Is Ananya Patil here? Is Ananya Patil in this group?
Ananya Patil from Bombay Scottish School, are you there? Yes. Hello, Ananya, are you there?
I guess not.
Okay, we'll move on then.
Yeah, but this is an interesting photo. Like, this girl is fighting this the coronavirus kind of thing. So, okay, nice photo, but she's not here now. Yeah. All right, let's move on to Samruddhi Kubal. If you are there, please respond. Samruddhi Kubal, this is what you have shared with us or sent to us. So you made a poster about this, about, you know, people using vaccines and stuff like that. So are you there, Samruddhi? Okay, maybe she's not there as well.
We move to group B now.
Okay, so let's go to group B posters.
Yeah.
1 second. Okay, so Rohini, can you please take over? I just share the screen.
Sure. So do we have Pranjal Kamre from Kendriya Vidyalaya number 1? Pranjal Kamre, are you there? Okay. Again, it's a very interesting poster. Okay, we may not be able to discuss this right now. Madhuri Kumari. Madhuri Kumari from KV number 1, Vasco da Gama. Okay, that's also a very nice poster. The third poster, we have Yashraj Ghute from Kendriya Vidyalaya AFS Nashik. Yashraj Ghute, are you there?
I'm just taking some time to load here, but
it's okay. I'm just checking the participant list. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Fine. No problem. Next one.
Yeah. Next one is Disha Vairkar from Amber International School. Disha, are you there? It's again a very interesting poster. I wish we could discuss all of these. Hello, Disha, are you there? Can we take group C, Kedar?
Okay, sure. We'll take group C, and maybe if this gets some join us later, we'll get back to them.
Yeah, they might join later. Yeah.
Sure. Let's do that. Okay.
So from group C, we have Tehsin Bhati from Rizvi College. Tehsin Bhati from Rizvi College.
So I want to ask this guy really, like, if he's around, you know, like when he's saying the earth is close to that kind of thing, what are these guys doing? Are they trying to pull the earth back? Are they trying to, like, you know, change the earth or free the earth?
Interesting question.
Yeah. Yeah. He's not here at the moment.
It looks like they just want to save the earth from, so it's just like from the corona. That is the message that I get with one look.
Yeah, you have this Grim Reaper on the side, and like the earth is rolling towards the Grim Reaper kind of thing. But
right.
Yeah,
or maybe they are unshackling, you know, because they are trying to break this chain in that previous poster. It looks like they are not just saving, they are trying to break this chain. You know, there's a chain and then they are trying to break it somehow.
I wouldn't know his thought process, but okay, I think he's not here. So let's move on. Next one.
Let's move. Nabiul Sheikh from Shama Prasad Mukherjee University. Do we have Nabiul Sheikh with us? Okay.
Rohini?
Yeah.
Yeah, so even if the participant is not there, someone among us can also comment on.
Yes, please. I mean, that'd be nice. Yeah, sure. Judges or anyone wants to comment about this?
Yeah.
Anyone wants to talk?
Subhajit, if you want to make some.
We have
comment
two of the judges here in the audience, so maybe they can comment on this.
And if you want me to bring up the previous one, just let me know. I'll bring it up.
This one also. I mean, we found it quite interesting, actually, that, he's trying to show basically the two faces of Corona. I mean, from whatever we are hearing in the news, that at one side, the earth is being free, as in nature is being like, we heard the news about animals roaming freely and also, I guess that is what he's trying to depict here. And other side, Corona is being devilish towards humans or something like that. So quite interesting way of depicting this. This is my interpretation, but it would be nice if.
Yeah, I also think the same, that it's showing the two faces of Corona. Very interesting that, there are two sides, two ways to look at an epidemic. Either it is saving the earth from humans or and here we are trying to save ourselves from Corona. So it's a very interesting question. I also agree.
Yeah. Anybody else who wants to comment on this? Okay. Let me tell the audience that Vinita is one of our judges and we are going to talk to her again towards the end. And thanks Subhajit and Vinita for your comments.
Okay.
If
he's here right now.
Some participant has come. Let's see if they have come. Otherwise,
yeah, Vivek is here. I think he was in the chat earlier.
Okay.
So.
Yeah.
Okay, Vivek, are you there? Can you unmute yourself and just tell us about yourself first, and then why you took this photograph? What are you trying to show here? Vivek, are you there?
You're on mute.
Hello.
Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes. Yes, we can.
Yeah, actually, this was a desperate time where we had this COVID-19 pandemic, and you can see over here as a tractor, Mahindra tractor has been used to distribute disinfectant over the colony area. This is my colony, actually. So this time, all the disinfectant was spread and sprayed everywhere, and these are the heroes which are using the tractor, which is not normally used for sowing the seeds in the farm, whereas now you are sowing the disinfect to kill the virus actually. And this is something different which we saw during the pandemic side, and we saw different side which has been used normally for vehicle. So what we can use it for the good purpose, in a way of bringing something to life. You can use that the same thing for even killing something and give life to the people, making them free from the virus and disease, which is in very fatal for them right now. This was my purpose of posting the photo.
Very nice explanation. Any questions from the audience, Vivek?
Anyone wants to ask a question, you can just put your hand up or unmute yourself and talk.
So many things are being repurposed for different things in this pandemic. And this is a very good example of
exactly.
Very nicely captured.
And by any chance, did you put that sign over there by the deliberately, or was it a mistake, like a package of boomers? And
that was already there. It was not deliberate.
Okay, that's nice.
Vivek, what do you do, Vivek?
Sir, I'm a PhD student right now. I'm from VS College, Subhajit, sir.
Oh.
Yeah, I hope you recognize. Yes. Subhajit, sir is my senior actually. Same college.
Very long ago. We are called Jurassic.
Yeah, very long ago. Exactly. Jurassic super senior. Jurassic senior, right.
Okay, Rohini,
Yeah, we can move. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Vivek. We'll just move on to the next one.
Yes.
Okay, so
Sakshi Bhagat, is she here?
Sakshi from Sophia College.
Okay, probably she's not there. This is actually, I thought this was like a nice idea, like having this, I don't know how to say it, but there's a painting about this by Michelangelo or something, and or I think Da Vinci, I forgot, about God touching man's hands kind of thing. So it's been interesting that the way you're trying to like, you know, pass on not knowledge or like life, but you're trying to pass on a mask.
Right.
That's a nice idea.
It's Michelangelo on
Michelangelo,
the
right.
Ceiling of Sistine Chapel.
Sistine Chapel, right, of course.
Interesting.
Okay, but any thoughts, anyone? Okay, we can move on then, Rohini.
Yeah, yeah. We have the next one by Ankita Dandekar from Chembur Sarvankash Shikshan Sanstha Mahavidyalaya. This is also interesting.
Hello, everyone. As you know, I am Ankita Dandekar from Chembur Sarvankash Shikshan Mahavidyalaya. It is a B.Ed. college in Chembur. So the topic which I took was education in COVID times, its innovation and challenges. So what I had experienced, I have presented that in the form of poster. So the message which I am trying to give is that education is beyond the four walls, which basically means education is not restricted between the four walls of any educational institution. We all know in this pandemic time, it has been stopped on all the activities. So we also know that educational institutions, all schools and colleges have been shut down since the March. But on other hand, we also know that education is always subjected to dynamic change, which means that it keeps on, education accepts the change that is going on in the environment. So with the help of technology, today teachers are able to impart the knowledge and pass their knowledge to the students. So various apps, like you can say Telegram, Google Classroom, Zoom, Facebook, all these platforms were used by the teacher to impart the knowledge to the students. Recently, I also read an article where a Kerala teacher used an innovative technique like augmented reality to explain different types of animal to the students. So it was really innovative. Now, this was one side. We live in India. We also know there are many places where we do not have access to all these resources. Like we don't have proper internet facilities. So what about that? So there all we need is nothing but dedications of the teachers to give knowledge to everyone, I feel. So recently in one article, I read that in Jharkhand, there was one teacher who installed a loudspeaker in his locality so that students could attend the lectures properly. So there is no stop on education process. Recently, even one Mumbai teacher, mathematics teacher video went viral where she was using a refrigerator tray to show to the students how to solve the mathematical problems. So basically the message which I want to try to convey is education is something that is dynamic in nature. It molds itself as per the environment, and education spreads more faster even than a virus. And education has a power to change the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Ankita, for that wonderful description. And I really liked your idea of, you really thought about people who are not able to get access to these technologies, and about how teachers are actually making out way so that education reaches those people also. Thank you.
Rohini.
Yes.
Rohini.
Yes.
Can
yes.
Can I sure. put a little bit?
Sure.
It's a nice poster, Education Beyond the Four Walls. Yeah, but again, where Ankita, you have taken the whole thing from your bookish point of learning. Yeah. Are you sure that you cannot learn anything from your homework, the today what you are doing, your washing clothes, your making cleaning utensils or brooming your house? Can you count that into education yourself? Do you learn something from it? And okay, that is within the four walls again. But still, education, and literacy? Since you are doing something on education, I'm putting this question to you.
Okay, so being a teacher, I would like to answer. My headline, my main topic, education beyond the four walls, means education doesn't mean what we are learning from book. Education is everything that we learn. Like one experience I would like to share to you, like when I was going to my college, I was not knowing the way how to go properly, right? So then by asking people how to go and all. So to learn exactly how to reach that point properly and safely is also something increasing our knowledge. So education is not only related to book, but education is everything that you learn around your environment.
Yeah, good point. I was just pointing out that you have made a 2 + 2 = 4, but you can again find out the geometry, the amount of flow you have swept. That's a calculation in mathematics. It's a suggestion. You can think over it. Good luck.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Pradeep, sir. Any other questions from comments from the audience?
Yeah, Rohini, if I may. Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, so it seems like these objects have a 3D feeling. So are they really 3D, or that's the effect you have made through this coloring?
No, it's actually a 3D effect. So what I thought I wanted to attract the eye of the person who is looking at, to attract someone, I thought to do something different. And to do this, I thought to do some 3D objects, maybe that may attract someone's eye and that can catch someone's eye easily.
And that chalk is actually a real chalk or you have painted?
Yeah, it's a real chalk.
I see, yeah. Okay, nice.
Thank you.
Someone with the name Galaxy 21 had raised his or her hand. Can you please ask your question? Galaxy M21, can you please ask your question? Okay.
Can I ask a question? I'm Jyotish.
Sure. Yeah.
So this is, Ankita, a very nice poster. I just wanted to sort of get a feel for how does one think of transmitting education in these current times in the poorer sections of the society, especially in villages? How do you think we can reach out where technology like online technologies may not be have a feasibility in terms of at this point? See, some of the children go to school. There are certain sections where children go to school just for the food. Apart from the education, because they don't, the households don't earn enough money, and it becomes a necessity out of, one has to go to school and then that person gets fed. In those situations, as well as situations where you cannot really reach out to the school teacher through online means, how do you think, and this is a general question for everyone in this context.
Yeah, just to add to that, I will just add one line to that. So Jyotishman, as he said, that it is much more challenging to reach out to poorer section of society. And I want to give one statistics to put the things in perspective. According to one of the surveys, fairly recent surveys, only 8% of Indian households own a smartphone or a computer at home. So that is the only, we will reach only that percentage of student population.
How much did you say? Could you repeat?
8%.
Yes. So 92% is away from it, right?
Yes.
So according to me, education is not completely dependent on technology. So as I told you earlier, I am a BA teacher. So we used to go for community work. So recently I had visited one community work, which was in Nehru's side somewhere. So there I saw a teacher was innovatively using various techniques to impart the knowledge to the students. So it is not completely dependent on technologies. Similarly, in post I had given one example of Jharkhand, where a sir, just to teach to his 200 students, he had installed the speakers in his locality, so that the learning process doesn't get stopped. So the imagination that we have that education is completely dependent on technology, it is not right. We can teach our students with the help of limited material also, and in very innovative ways also.
I understand. But in the case of social distancing and other kinds of situations, it's a general question. How do I reach out to the maximum kids?
Jyotishman, can I butt in as well? So I think it's a very pertinent question in education, and based, you know, we have to also look at this problem scientifically. So where do we know that the infection is spreading? We know that the infection spreads in closed spaces, in classrooms. It's a likely high density of students sitting in a closed classroom space is going to create problems. So many other schools, at least I've read reports like that schools have, at least schools in villages, where in Bombay, these are not possibilities that are easily executable, but schools that are in rural villages where their space, do have space, they start educating in open spaces. They should we should go back to the quote unquote Shantiniketan type of model, right? Where open space education should be brought back into reality, at least for the current immediate future, so that we don't lose out on this time. That's what my
thank you, Shubhaji.
Shubha, I'll just add on. Actually, what Jyotishman has raised is a really interesting, and most of us are working on it. And what I would suggest that, that's a different, it will be a long topic to discuss.
Yes.
Visit Anand Niketan site also, where actually I'm also involved indirectly or directly. You will see the Shantiniketan and Sevagram, both places, how in the rural education can be taken up, where there is a lot of open spaces there, and children can be made to work from home, and some tasks can be passed on to the children. They can report to the teachers at regular intervals, etc. So we may be able to take up this topic at now. We can go. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. We'll now move on to the next poster. Kedar, can you please share the next poster?
Yeah, in a moment.
Yeah.
Sorry, just a moment.
Yes.
Is it clearly visible?
Yes, it is visible.
Yeah, Isha Pauli, I think you are here in this chat. Can you please tell us about this? It is an interesting photograph. What exactly is happening here? Isha, I believe you're here in this chat. Can you hear us?
Isha is there, yes.
Yeah.
Isha, we can't hear you, Isha.
You can unmute yourself and...
She's unmuted. Isha, can you please say something about this photograph? Okay, she's posted. Due to pandemic, we are locked into a house, and even if we move out in emergency, we have to wear a mask and we are still not able to move around freely. Okay, that's what Isha has written in the Zoom chat. And it's a very nice photograph. So we can have a discussion around this.
Yeah, I have a question for Isha actually.
Yeah.
So Isha, how have you exactly taken this photograph? Is it taken in monochrome? How do you maintain the green color? Have you edited the rest of the photo and maintained the colors here?
Okay, she has edited.
Okay. So it's not, the entire photo has been taken in monochrome or maybe colored, and the rest is made black and white, something like that. Okay, that's.
She said the photo is taken in monochrome. I can hear her faintly. The photo is taken in monochrome and then the color is added separately.
Okay.
Isha, are you there? Okay, I can just type out your answer. Are you trying to suggest any psychological problem involved with the child while showing this poster?
Yes. She's trying to show that.
So
I guess so, because locking down children for a very long time, with a lack of mobility, even adults with a confined space, may give rise to what's that called, claustrophobia. And that may be one of the problems that we have to face. I'll suggest that you think of the solution to that also. Thank you.
At this point, I will also point out mental health due to lockdown is an issue which is not often discussed, but there are good materials available. One source I can definitely say is ISRC website. Just search for Indian Scientists Response to COVID-19. And one of the booklets which they prepared was about mental health due to pandemic. And people should read that. It is a very simple story to read. And
that Aniket, could you post that in the group?
I'll send a link.
Yeah, good.
Any other comment or question from the audience for this photograph?
I just have one small question here for Isha. Yeah. I like the photograph a lot. I mean, it was very good thing. But tune kisko bakra banaya? Is it actually a hit for banda? Did you get my question, Isha?
He's her brother.
Oh, your brother.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. That's really, really evil of you. But anyway, it's a nice photograph. Thank you very much. So, Rohini, can we move on then?
Sure.
Okay. Right. So I'll go to the next thing.
Which class she is in?
Isha, you're in which class? Second year BSc.
Papa.
Okay. Right. Let's move on then. The next thing we are supposed to do here, I'll just stop sharing my screen for now, is we're going to have a small discussion with some people, some students basically from the CEBS, the Center for Excellence in Basic Sciences in Mumbai. And these students, we've called them on here because we want to know a few things, like, you know, how they think about it. As adults, as scientists, as teachers, you know, we have different ways of looking at things, but how do the students weave a few things about the scientific temper? So I'll first invite them and I'll ask them to tell us a bit about themselves one by one, and then we can move on to the questions. So I'll invite Mohammed Nishan, you're here. Just raise your hand or say hi.
Hi.
Great. Hello. There you are. Okay, so I'll come back to you in a moment. And Saskuti Karnavat, are you here?
Yeah.
Okay, Vishal, I'm sorry, I can't pronounce your last name clearly. Maybe I'll make a mistake. So Vishal is good.
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, you're good. You're here. All right. And Jay, are you here as well?
Yeah, I'm here. Yeah.
Okay. So I want you guys to just quickly go in some order and just tell us one by one as to what you're doing, like why you're doing it, what are your interests for the future, maybe a minute for that. And then we'll come to asking you some questions about how you think about what Mars for Science is all about and so on. Okay, so please, Mohammed, can you start?
Yeah, if I may add, like, I think this children are there, it's being a normal classroom kind of thing. So I just want to say that whenever they want to say something, they can unmute themselves and interact with them, the speaker. So you also encourage them to ask questions. I think they're somehow feeling shy.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
So hello everyone, I'm Mohammed Nishan. I'm fifth year, final year of integrated MSc from CEBS. I did my master's thesis project work on cancer biology, basically in drug discovery and effects of cancer drugs, cancer medication on human cells. So what spurred me onto this particular field is that, you see, everybody knows cancer is a very deadly disease and we do not have a cure per se for cancer. So why is that so? Why is it so difficult to tackle this particular disease? And what makes cancer different from other diseases which affect human body? These are the questions which spurred my curiosity going into this field. At the same time, not just in cancer, when you look at any particular phenomenon or when you see something happening around you, it's that innate curiosity which makes you ask, like, why is that happening? How is that happening? And what are the required prerequisites for a car to move or a bird to fly or anything that you see around you to happen? It is this basic curiosity which I think is what drives students into science and like make them stay in the field, because that's what matters. Curiosity is what matters.
Okay, that's nice. Thanks. Maybe the next one, let's say Sansuti.
Yeah. So yeah, I'm Sanskriti. So I'm doing maths from CBS. I'm currently in my fourth year, and
So Sanskriti, what do you think about scientific temper, and what made you?
Rohini, can you just like the others also introduce us once, and then we can.
Oh, it's the introduction session? First. Okay.
Yeah. Please. I just want to know for a moment, because you didn't introduce completely.
All right.
You didn't tell us, like, you know, why, for example, you take up math.
Oh.
Yeah. Because, see, I mean, the whole idea of this program is to encourage the people, the young people out there, you know, who are watching this program, as to, you know, what is science about, and, like, why do people do science in the first place?
Hmm.
What's so interesting about it, right? So please tell us about that.
So, like, as Nisham said, I think for me also, a lot of things, I mean, asking questions is something which brought me into science, because that's
okay. No problem.
Just a second.
Okay, so, we'll come back to you again later in more detail, but Vishal, can you go on now?
So good evening, everyone. I'm Vishal Kalishwaran, a first year undergraduate student at CABS Mumbai. I haven't decided my stream yet, but I look forward to pursuing chemistry as my major. And yeah, in chemistry, I'm open to all ideas, as I'm at a very early stage of my career. But I find organic synthesis and drug discovery and a whole envelope of medicinal chemistry particularly interesting. And I have also been doing some reading on medicinal chemistry recently. Yeah, so that's about me.
Thank you.
To me, why I wanted to come into this beautiful scientific community is started from my home environment itself. Like, since we are in an Indian culture, and my family particularly being a bit orthodox also, the idea pushed upon by them, my senior Nisham mentioned, we have all this innate curiosity within ourselves, right? So I kept questioning, and I tried pointing out what was contradicting in their statements and what should be the proper way to put this out to people. And all those customs, traditional customs, superstitions that people have. And this made me keep questioning. The other part where I started this habit of questioning everything is in my school, especially, which was very much focused on getting marks and stuff, which although I was able to score, but I didn't like the idea of them overemphasizing everything else. Okay, and I felt that didn't make me learn anything more than what I know already. So I want, and when I tried to question them, I was always labeled, he's a very argumentative kid. He doesn't respect elders and stuff. So this thing I never liked about being in a school. And hence I naturally wanted to be a part of a community where I was accepted and where I can question freely. Okay. So even though I may be wrong, I can at least put forward my opinion, and I can also point at others who may be wrong, even though they are elderly, without being disrespectful for them. Yeah. So that sparked me into this community, and I have been into 1 year into CBS, so I have been liking it in Mumbai And Mumbai being an education hotspot, it's been a good journey till now. Yeah.
Okay, very well said, Vishal. It's nice to hear that. And last you have Jay, and then we get some of the questions. Jay?
Jay? Hello?
Sorry. I forgot to unmute myself. Yeah.
Right. Okay.
So, hi. My name is Jay. I'm currently in second year. I will be going to third year and a student at CEBS. And my major that I have taken is biology. So as Nisham and Vishal mentioned ago, I think one of the most attractive things about science that I found was the fact that, you know, curiosity, like you question things around you, there's a constant need to know about stuff around you. I have that. So that's one of the reasons why I sort of came towards science. Also, in a scientific environment, there is a lot of free constructive discussions that take place, which is really good for me because I like talking or discussing things with people about which I'm passionate. Also, one very satisfying feeling that one gets from finding something new or something that you did not know before, that is also like one of the things that happens to you daily in science. So that was why majorly I came into science.
Okay, thank you, Vishal. I'm sorry, thank you, Jay. And let's now go to the questions. So I think Rohini has the first question there. Can you begin, Rohini?
Yeah, so my question is to all four of you as to what do you think about scientific temper and how would you say, where is our society currently with respect to that? What's your idea of scientific temper? We want to hear from you. So we can go from, we can start from Nisham and then.
Okay, so the idea of scientific temper, like when you say scientific temper, it's not necessarily something that is exclusively in the hands of scientists or science students only. So scientific temper is something that is within you already. It is something that you just should use because it's also synonymous with common sense. When you look at something and you see and you feel that it's suspicious, you judge as to whether it's good for you or it's bad for you, whether its effects are good, whether its effects are bad. When your parents tell you to brush your teeth, when you're just 4 years old, 3 years old, 5 years old, you don't think much about it. But as you grow older, you learn in school that brushing your teeth is good for your health. So your teachers teach you that. So during your early ages, like you're 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years old, during that time, you develop this basic understanding of the world from which now you can derive more complicated answers to more complicated questions. In a sense, it could be simple debates that you have with your friends, or it could be an argument which you are having with your teacher. But scientific temper is not just a part of education, it's also a part of daily life. Like when you make a chapati, do you know why the dough puffs? Why the chapati puffs? I mean, it's a very simple question. Not everyone knows the answer either. It's simply because the water molecules which evaporate form small bubbles, and this dough of chapati is actually a kind of fluid. And as it dries out, these bubbles coalesce together and then it becomes one big bubble. That's how chapati is puffed. It's a simple answer. And as a child in 8th, 9th, 10th standard, and if you have had the curiosity of blowing bubbles, you know that there are bubbles which are made from, which come out of water. You know there is water in chapati dough. And 1 + 2 = 3. So you can come to this conclusion even though it may not be precise. This, applying this particular mindset, way of thinking to daily life is what I believe is scientific temperament. So when you see something, you question it, either yourself, and you form an opposite opinion. You say that it is like this, this is why it's happening. And then within yourself, you form an opposite opinion saying that it's not how it's happening. And then you argue within yourself and you find the solution. And then you present the solution to your friends, or you present the solution to your relatives, and then ask them as to, is this how you think this happens? And if it is so, they'll say yes. And that, when they say it's, that's how it is happening, you feel elated, you feel happy that you found it out yourself. Scientific temper not only improves the quality of your life, it also brings happiness. So that's what scientific temper is for me.
Yeah, nicely presented, Nisham. Do we have questions from the audience? Even student participants, students who have joined us today, please feel free to ask and interact with them.
Yeah, I would like to ask the students, why do you think the word temper? Is it about getting angry about something?
I would say it's about our state of mind, right? Like how we are thinking with regards to scientific temper. You bring up the word temper because it involves your state of mind, what you think about this object, what you think about this method, or what you think about something like Nisham mentioned about this. So I would say it's not real. I mean, you could draw some extrapolations to anger, but I would say it's just about the state of mind, and hence the word temperament.
So you can also look at it technically, right? Like etymologically, or from the root word kind of thing, which you, when you break down a particular word and then look for its meaning. So temper actually comes from temperament, or to temper. I mean, the process of making swords or metal objects, you beat it multiple times so that it forms a particular shape. That process is called tempering. So when you change the way you think, scientific temper, what it does is that it makes you think in a particular way, where you question things and you hammer onto yourself different ideas and then shape it in a way that it's a final finished product. You don't take anything raw. Like someone tells you something that this is how it happens, that's a raw information. You don't take it. You process it within yourself. So you temper it. That's what I think.
Thanks, Nisham. And thanks, Nisham. Thanks.
That's very interesting.
Yeah.
Good answer, Rohini. I want to put a question to all four of them. It seems that you have selected all different branches of branches. Can you think of your branch, your own branch, without any involvement of the other branch?
So I have taken biology, and as far as biology goes, I mean, I cannot see biology without looking at chemistry or physics or maths, because all of that is very much integrated into how the things happen inside your body or inside cells, etc. So as a subject, biology is a very compound sort of a thing. It has all other subjects inside it, but it is still different from each of the subjects. I mean, it has a sort of emergent quality to it.
Okay, thanks.
Others? Yeah. Others? Any response?
Yeah. Sanskriti, please.
Yes. I think... So I study maths, and I think I can very much see it as a separate subject from the other three streams, physics, chemistry, and biology, because I don't see any, I mean, there might be influences from there to, for example, develop techniques to solve their problems, but as such, I don't see much overlap.
Yeah, thank you. I just want to share one scientist's view. To make things a little lighter. One of the physicists tried to do something of biology. And then after some time, he gave up, saying that there are too many variables. So science is involving a lot of variables. Somewhere there are more, somewhere there are less. But there is always the interconnection, in my opinion. Thank you.
Yes, that's an interesting point. Thank you, Pradeep, sir. Do others want to say something about this?
Yeah, so yeah. From my perspective, I've been doing biology for 4 years now, but that doesn't mean that I am completely out of touch with other fields either, because going forward, now more than ever before, interdisciplinary sciences is a thing which is required for further research. Because if you look at biology, as Pradeep sir said, there's too many variables. So if you are going to determine whether a drug, for example, is effective, or a particular organ is damaged and that damage is the reason for a particular disease, you need to be sure about this. To be sure about this, you use statistics, and statistics is math. That is just numbers game. Now, if you go further ahead, there's modeling, where you try to model how brain cells, nerves talk with each other. That's again a lot of physics, where you model a single nerve as a group of capacitors, resistors, and wires connected to each other, and then you go forward. And then obviously medicines are chemistry, and all of these things are tied together in whichever field of science that you look at. If you look at math, for example, there's a lot of application of math that's coming into all of these different fields of science, and the same for physics and chemistry. In case of biology especially, like I have to stay up to date with the latest statistical techniques, as well as advancements in optics, like for microscopes and different advanced type of microscopes, for example, so that in my field I can also stay ahead. I mean, this has become a necessity now. So interdisciplinary science is what is the future and what's happening nowadays.
Can I ask a question, so, Rohini?
Yeah, sure.
So, I mean, you guys are all from the quote-unquote, you know, basic sciences or STEM sciences. What are your opinions on the social sciences, for example, or, you know, sciences that are not part of these four mainstreams? How do you see making those sciences inclusive as part of your scientific temper?
So I think it's a very relevant question, because so we are citizens of a country, or let's say we stay in a society. But the thing is, because there are a lot of factors involved in social sciences which seem to be out of any kind of control, I think that is one reason why I chose not to study social sciences. And to be really honest, for example, what happens in politics, so it is really difficult to make sense of why those things happen, because it is such a complex thing. However, what I feel is, without dealing with the complexity involved, so using the way we do science, I don't think it will be very easy to understand those things at the same time.
So basically, you're saying that no one can predict politicians' behavior, right?
Yeah.
All right, yeah. Yes, let's answer the same question. From Subhoshi, please.
Can I also say something? I think when we talk about science, or generally all maths, physics, chemistry, biology, for me, when we talk about science, it's more of a way of thinking than the actual subject, like a scientific way of thinking. And when you apply it to different things, you apply it to, say, computers, or you apply it to physics or matter around you, etc., then it develops into a science. So social science is also sort of like this. You have a sort of scientific way of thinking, and you're trying to apply it to society around you. But the difference in what these sciences that we have and that is that, like, the nature of complexity is different, and also you can exert a certain amount of control in the laboratory, but when you're doing social science, it's very hard. Majorly what you're doing is not experimenting, but analyzing data.
Yeah. So, Vijay, do you want to add?
If I may.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So, in the context of doing science and social science, after all, humans are social animals. So, it's quite impossible to stay away from social science and exclusively just do science and be completely objective about it, because the ground reality is that social disparities and inequalities that we see around us, people coming from economically weaker sections of society, oppressed sections of society, and people who are not seen as the mainstream kind of person, like those people find it difficult to enter this field of objective thinking and science and what one may call privileged section of society. So as scientists and as students and as people who are already in this particular section, in this group of discussion, I think it's our responsibility to make sure that the opportunity is available to everyone. It's fair, it's equal, and it's justifiably equal. So a bit of social science and administration and all of these things come into play when you look at the human side of science, other than just the objective experimental laboratory side of science. There's also this human side which we are talking about.
Great. Thanks, Nisha. Thanks a lot. Rohini?
Yes, Subhajit, you want to say something?
No, I just wanted to say that I'm really happy that the students are thinking this way, because I think we have to make these spaces inclusive for all sciences, right? I mean, we can't think of silos, living in silos like we lived for 40 years, 50 years there. Biology was separate. Even in biology, zoology and botany were separate from each other. Today, I'm glad that we are all talking to each other. We are talking on a common platform. And going forward, I'm glad these are the torchbearers of our science going forward, our march for science. And it's important that they speak up about these kind of issues where the interdisciplinary nature of science should be taken forward here onwards. I'm glad that they are talking about it. Thanks.
May I add, Rohini, just
yes,
a bit,
sir. Yes, sir.
Shubhajit just encouraged me to this. Nisham has been doing it, have answered very well, a lot of things. See, one of the comments I heard in one of the conferences, the kitchen knife was invented to cut vegetables. There is no guarantee that you cannot commit murder with it. So it's a scientific people will have to think in social and other science, other parts of social humanities also, so that the knife does not fall into wrong hands. Thank you. And great thinking, Nisham. You must encourage your other friends to sit down and discuss problems of social equity and others, so that a science, results of research in science do not fall into wrong hands. Thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So Kedar, hello.
Okay, so yeah, I have a question which is a bit connected. It's a bit different, but something which always bugs me. Kind of. So let me just ask this here. Since there are like four of you on this panel, and there's only one girl and three boys, and we always hear this thing that girls don't do science or they can't do science, and somehow people like parents, for example, will stop the girls from going into pure sciences. Okay, engineering karlo. That's okay. You don't really go into science and do research and make a career out of that. So I really want to ask, first of all, Saswati here, and then any of you can answer as well. Why is it that we are doing so? Why is there a real reason why girls don't come into science in this country? Is there a real problem or real hurdle that you're facing? Or is it just that, it's a social structure, so you just don't go beyond that? Saswati, can you just talk to this, please?
Just give me 2 minutes to consolidate. I mean, by that, during that time, someone else can talk if they
okay, want. Maybe someone else can then begin. And as guys, we should think about this as well. It's not only the girl's problem. Yeah, so anyone. My question basically is that, why are we, are we stopping ourselves? Are we stopping the girls in our society from going ahead?
Yeah.
Are stopping ourselves? What's going on?
I was just trying to kick off the discussion. I mean, what we learn from science? What do we learn from science? We have been studying the human brain for so many years now. We know that that you know, capacities of our brain are not limited by our sexes. And yes, there are people who think differently. Some people are more inclined to, you know, analytical thinking. Some people are more inclined to artistic endeavors. But at the end of the day, our brain, the tissue, is not any different. The way the tissue connects to each other is not any different. And I think before, we had segregated these, you know, that the man will go out and bring home the bacon and the woman will stay home and, you know, take care of the kids. I mean, that spaces which we had separated today are slowly, I mean, not ever as fast as we want them to be, but are slowly overlapping. And I think the lockdown is teaching many of us that the same thing as well. And you know, that is what I think that we going forward as scientists, we have to understand how to bridge these spaces together. So that's what I want the students to kind of opine as to what do you think can be done to you know, bridge the gap between you know, bring the girl children into education spaces, into scientific spaces, because we see a large void even in CBS as well. In this representation itself, it's a 1:3, right? So Sanskriti, what do you think we should be able to do better going forward in March for science?
So I think one important thing is, and it is not just related to science, I think it is important to break chains of any sort of discrimination that we see happening around us. For example, I mean, particularly for me, I was very lucky because my parents, for example, and for example, my teachers did not, you know, love me less because I was born a girl. But the thing is, there's still, I mean, even in our everyday life, there are biases. For example, in my school, no one used to, you know, play outdoor games. And if I wanted to play, I mean, there was no one with whom I could play So, I mean, except for me, I didn't see anyone else interested in playing sports. So what I want to say is that if we see any kind of discrimination happening around us, I think it is important to raise voice at that instant.
I love it because what you're saying is that, you know, whenever you see a discrimination, some people keep quiet, and keeping quiet is actually, you know, you're aiding the discriminator, and you're not, by keeping quiet, you're not, you know, you're not doing justice. So we must speak up. I think speaking up is not an option. So
Also, I think, and to a certain extent, in our society, there was a split of what a man should do and what a woman should do, like a separate spaces for each of them, right? So even as in occupations, you can see that, like, certain occupations are, you know, like, say, engineering, that is a more male-dominated field, or, you know, it's considered like when, at least as far as getting, like, the sex ratio in engineering colleges is much less compared to medical colleges, right? So that way, even in CBS, if you look at it, like, the number of girls that are in biology is much more than in any other stream. So I think in society, that sort of a bias is ingrained. And maybe that is one of the we need to break that bias, and we need to, you know, shift from that to just going to whichever option is better for you.
So and I would, yeah, okay, go, okay, Nisham. Okay,
Vishal, carry on. I'll go up.
Vishal, yeah, go on.
Yeah. So as Jay said, and as Subhojit sir said, you talked about the brain tissue and how it is not different. I mean, how it is. Everyone has an equal capability to like something and dislike something, equal probability, if you say. So as to how to improve the situation, or how to improve the situation in India specifically, I think this as a form of awareness can be brought by MASHPA Science to the weaker sections of the society, or
to the rural areas in the society. I mean, in the urban areas, it is being taught in school, it is being taught to everyone. So they are being constantly streamed with this information. But in other areas, where we see this gender discrimination very much, we could probably organize something to bring awareness about, in a scientific basis, how it is equally probable for both the sexes to do something. And also, when we have our women professors doing the same thing, carrying out the same, it will act as an added motivation for the girl child to take up work in STEM or something. That is what I feel.
Right. Mohammed, do you have to say something?
Yeah. So as Vishal said, one important thing is that people have, students especially, and children have role models. So if a girl sees a woman being very successful in a particular field that is male dominated, for example, that can act as a catalyst for her to follow up in that field. And another thing is that when we come across and try to push forward for a better society, people within the scientific circle itself who are slightly conservative in nature and traditionalist, and people who are not as woke as people who are pushing for this, try to argue against it by saying that, like, look at these mammals, look at these animals, like male animals are bigger than female animals, so they should be below us, and all those kinds of arguments. But one very interesting observation when you look at this particular thing in the case of humans is that when a human baby is born, both the male and female baby is physically, moral, brain-wise, and structurally, and in case of their physical strength, are more or less the same. And one important thing to note is that human babies are the babies that are born with largest heads or most developed heads. By the time of 9 months of birth, their brain has developed much further ahead compared to any other animals with respect to their own adult brains. So one thing that we find from this is that we use our brain more than our physical strength to achieve our certain goals. So when you look at the brains, as Subhajit sir rightly so pointed out, capabilities are more or less the same. There is no big difference between a cisgender male or a transgender male, or a cisgender female or a transgender female. So all these things, when you look at it scientifically as well as through experiments, and even from a social point of view, from a humanities point of view, we see that inclusion is the right way ahead, because by keeping away 50% of us humans, we are taking away 50% of different ideas, different opinions, and the way forward which we could have. Maybe all the difficulties that we have faced as mankind till now could have been a result of keeping away those 50% of ideas which was already there. So opening avenues and making science and anything in the world for that matter accessible to everyone not only helps uplift that particular section of society, but is in itself a better thing for mankind.
Wonderful thought. I think Ankita here has a question to all of you regarding this, or she has to say, make a comment. Ankita? Are you able to hear me, Ankita? Yeah.
Sir, I would like to add something over here. Can I?
Sure, please go on.
So basically what I want to say is there is nothing that can, in current situation, I feel there is nothing that can stop a woman to pursue anything. All she needs is the support from her family so that she can pursue her future successfully. And to do this, all we can do is to break the gender stereotype that has been fixed in the society, or the gender roles we can see. So as we all are here, I would really like to take the opportunity and request you all to bring the change from ourselves. If we change today our mentality, then might be the society can change tomorrow. The ratio is might be less of a woman in engineering or medical, but it is quite better than the past if I compare. So all I feel is we need to change our mentality to see towards the gender roles that have been fixed by the society, and we need to change this all.
Thank you, Ankita. It's a very important point.
I think. I want to add
Absolutely.
It's actually, so I mean, even though we are talking about such big things, but it's not very simple. For example, so during lockdown, so my uncle has a medical store, and so he met a person there who never knew how to, who has never used soap ever in his life. So what I want to, so why am I bringing this example? The thing is, we are talking about trying to educate people where the state is this. So it will education will not just happen, by spreading awareness. I think it is high time that we, we just got the new education policy, but the thing is, it needs to, I mean, we need to find ways by which we can reach those people. So gender stereo, so in context of gender discrimination and any other kind of discrimination, these kind of things start right there, when we are children. So, and for me, one important factor which played a role in keeping a clear mind about such things was that these concepts were introduced in our books in class 6th, 7th, and 8th. The whole civics books were filled with concepts of equality and such kind of things. I mean, and the constitutional values that we are talking about now. So I think it is very important to get these things across to people in some solid ways. That's what I wanted.
Can I add something here, Kedar?
Yeah, please go on.
This is Jyotish Mal. I just want to switch on the video. Yeah, I think, Kedar, you have brought on a absolutely important question in this kind of a context. And I think, I guess we all, you, me, and all the younger generation here, Shubhajit, all of us actually have our own stories and of how we have seen situations where I guess a female colleague or a student in our schools or at our neighborhood, right? How the discrimination happens in terms of even simple tasks that you think you should be able to do, but for a girl it becomes harder because the pressure from the parents is enormous. That even if I want to go out for some place, a simple task of going out and buying something from a market or something, and there are time restrictions, there are things that are so ingrained in our culture which tell you it actually happens for a girl every day, that it hits you that from a very young age that you can't do this, there are restrictions, you can't do that, there are restrictions, you have to think about this 10 times, right? And that is, it does not end at a very young age, it actually builds on. And also, it's also the guys, the boys like me, or what we see at home. We grow up, when we are being in school, we grow up with my mother taking care of me all the time. And the father, at least for my father, it was very hard for him to take care of my studies or anything, right? So this actually, again, is an asymmetry. This is a fundamental asymmetry. We have to come out of this asymmetry. The boys and the girls have equal responsibility for education of their kids. And that in itself actually is inbuilt in our system. That the girls actually see it, that in future what they are going to have to do, right? And this is not something that is easy to come out of. We can say all these things about, we have to reach out to more women, we have to reach out to more, we have to see what the issues are. But these, somebody, Nisham, actually pointed out very well, the babies are the same, right? When they're born as boy or the girl, but it's the programming that we do that affects the brain in the way we think. And I guess this is where, to me, I think that is a major difference. And I think all of us, we understand it, but you know, we have to solve it through our own changes of mentality. And this goes a long way. It actually also goes in the way female colleagues in my institute, TIFR, my institute, how female colleagues are seen versus male colleagues, there is an undercurrent, okay? And this, at my level, I'm saying this, at a much younger level, you have seen, I think the college students have seen this. I don't know where it will stop, but this is one of the big issues that I guess plagues us. The other part is, but Nisham's point is something about, see, I think science and doing the scientific temperament is just like, you know, science itself as a body. It's essentially, if you were to think of my opinion, is it's like the virus connecting the living and the non-living. We are always at the border of what we know and what we don't know, what is unknown, right? And to reach out to the unknown, we have to correct our what is known. So I think the temperament lies in our own understanding is what is known. If we understand what is known, and if we really go after what is known, I think what is unknown becomes easier to handle. We really do not have good ways to justify. Or roti kaise wo phulta hai? That question. How well have we studied that? It is something that is a known phenomenon, right? So have we really gone at the depths of understanding that? I really like that example from Nisham. Thank you, Nisham, for these wonderful words. I think Pradeep sir also mentioned it. I think you have a very mature way of looking at things. So, but I would like to say that this is essentially for the disparity in the gender. I think as Ankita pointed out, and I think Sanskriti also referred, I think all of this boils down to our own everyday life situations, which we need to think about two times or three times of how to, you know, work around it. Thank you.
Yeah,
like if you make them play with dolls, yeah, they'll become girls. If you make them play with guns, they become boys. It's all up to us whether we break this up or not. Yeah, at least Pradeep, go on.
Sanskriti and what's the name? Both, I congratulate both of you. Sanskriti, though you said that you have not connected the humanities, but you have so well pointed out. I'm very happy that you have understood the problem very clearly. And I'm very sure in the years to come, you will come up and with the solutions, I will move forward. You people are our hopes. You, Sanskriti, I congratulate you. We have understood the problem. You are right. You'll have to go ahead. We have made progress. Definitely, more and more women are coming into science. But more and more men also have to get into domestic work. That is one of the things you have to do. And that is where the equality will lie. I'm sure you will go ahead and find the solution yourself. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir. We now move to the last part of today's session, that is the prizes. And we are now going to announce the prizes. So I'll request Kedar to share the screen. So as you all know, there were three categories based on the different academic levels for students. And we also had three judges. We had Dr. Vinita Navalkar, who is a research associate at CEBS with a background in X-ray astronomy. Then we had Aditi Murlidhar from Homi Bhabha Center for Science Education, who works in environment education, design and technology education. And Dr. Ashutosh Mure, who is working at the Somaya Center for Experiential Learning. So based on their judgment, and I believe Vinita and Ashutosh are there, so we begin with the... sorry, Kedar, can you?
Yes. The first, you can see the thing on your end. Your names are on your list, and I'll put up the certificate.
Sure.
You can read out the name, and I'll put up the certificate up.
Sure. So the in the group A poster category, the second prize goes to Ananya Patil from Bombay Scottish School. Then the
these
first
certificates. Kedar, these are participation certificates.
I'm sorry, I did not get the other ones. But maybe I'm sorry, I'll send them later with the students directly.
Okay, we'll shall I just announce the names then?
I'll put up the participants at least they can see their name on the screen so they'll know. Sure. Will know who they are. Like,
can we also see the associated work that got the prize?
I'll try to do that.
So Kedar, you just display the posters and
okay, we'll do it.
Rohini, you can say the names.
Sure,
I'll do that. Okay, so Ananya Patil, I'll just bring her up here. This is what she's done.
Yeah, that's the poster that has won the second prize in category A. Then for the first prize in the same category, Samruddhi Kubal from Amber International School.
So. This is her work?
Yes, that's the poster by Samruddhi.
By chance, are they here? I mean, are they around? Any of these people? If you're here, please give us a hand, give us a shout that you're here. Okay, next one.
So in category B, the second prize goes to Yashraj Ghute from KV Ojhar Nashik.
Okay.
And the first prize, just a minute. The first prize goes to Disha Vairkar from Amber International School. Okay. Then in category C, second prize goes to Sakshi Bhagat from Sophia College for Women. And first prize goes to Ankita Dandekar. And Ankita is there, right?
Yes.
Congratulations, Ankita.
Thank you, ma'am.
I'm now announcing the prizes for the second category. So we had posters and we had entries for photographs. The third prize goes to, so there's overall first, second and third. The third prize goes to Krishna Chauhan from St. Xavier's High School. Krishna Chauhan. Krishna's there, right?
He was here earlier.
Okay. Right? Maybe he's dropped.
Krishna, are you around? Okay. Maybe you can't hear him.
Yes.
He's there, right? Good. Congratulations.
Congrats, Krishna.
Thank you, miss.
The second prize goes to Vivek Parab from SIES College of Science, Arts and Commerce. Vivek, are you there?
He was there earlier.
Yeah.
Was there earlier?
Okay, that wins the second prize. And the first prize goes to Isha Pavre from Elphinstone College. So Isha is there, right? Congratulations, Isha.
Thank you, ma'am.
So the winners will be getting books from Breakthrough Science Society on different topics like scientific temper, inquiry, and history of science. We'll be mailing you asking for your details for the prizes to be sent. And all participants will be getting a certificate. So any of the participants want to say something? Okay. That brings us to the end of the program. And I would like to thank all the students who joined us today for this program. Your presence really meant a lot, especially the discussion that we had with you, both over the poster or photos, as well as the senior students who joined us. I would also like to thank Arnav for his wonderful talk on masks. You really told us how we are getting tricked by the numbers and the words that people use to sell their mask and to just increase their business, and how we really have to think scientifically while talking about the masks. I would also like to thank all the
Rohini,
members.
Vishal wants to add something, he said.
Okay, yes, Vishal. Vishal, you can go on.
Yeah, no, sorry to interrupt. I have just put it out in the chat, like on the basis of scientific temperament that we were discussing. I would just put add a perspective to it. We say religion as a way of life, and although it's not true in many cases, but I see having a scientific temperament as like that. It is like a way of life. It helps me live in a particular way, and it monitors everything that I do. It governs everything that I do. If I want to choose this product over there, not everything can be analyzed based on scientific temperament, but yeah, so to a certain extent, adding this temper to our daily basis is very important. And as I see it as a way of life. And I encourage some people to think in this perspective and their comments if possible.
Yeah, thank you, Vishal, for that comment. So I would like to thank all the people from the organizing committee, all members from March for Science Mumbai, who since the ideation of this event have been contributing for this session today. And finally, I would like to say that this pandemic has really sounded an alarm that the future is not going to be very rosy thing. It's going to be very difficult, and it is also very hard to imagine that these young students are probably going to spend a lot of time in defending science than doing science. But we do have a chance, and the chance is now. We have to act now to make sure that a lot of funding is given for science, that all the policies are based on scientific evidence, and we really stand united for science. We don't allow any unscientific ideas to pass. If you all believe that this can be done and you want to join us in doing this, then please try to connect us through social media. We are there on Facebook, YouTube, Insta, and Twitter. And keep watching our YouTube channel for also Facebook page for any further announcements on other events. With that, I would like to say thank you to all. Stay home, stay safe.
Okay, thank you everybody for a wonderful discussion. Goodbye, everyone.